So back to the frame buffer. The Linux frame buffer may belong to the past, but even if the frame buffer support in free software is often not maintained and sometimes just removed, I propose to come back today on these free softwares able to run on the frame buffer. I'm going to start with simple examples to remind you basics. I will show some tools. I will talk about two libraries that can be used for drawing in the frame buffer. OpenGL rendering with the frame buffer will be addressed. We will discuss on the frame buffer output in multimedia frameworks, and we will cover graphics libraries and user interface toolkits that provide a frame buffer port. Let's go. For checking that the frame buffer is responding well, a simple test to do is to run the cat command. Here, we have filled the frame buffer with random values. In practice, the standard mmap system call is used. We first open the frame buffer device file to get a file descriptor, and we pass it to mmap in order to map the frame buffer device in memory. A pointer is returned and is represented here with 3 RGB bytes per pixel. We just have to fill this array in order to display on screen. So, for drawing a blue rectangle, we fill the corresponding area by setting the 255 value in bytes for the blue and 0 in bytes for the green and red. Let's compile this example with GCC and run it. The example is written with very few lines of code. We compile it. Okay, we have the blue rectangle. For getting familiar with the frame buffer, I suggest to have a look on FBTest app on FBMark softwares. The FBTest app software proposes FBTest for checking the color rendering on FBString for drawing a string in the frame buffer. The FBMark software proposes some animations based on popular fractals on the test bench with rectangles. When running programs on the frame buffer, we don't have a compositor for moving and resizing windows. So I take care to specify the size and the position when starting programs in order to avoid overlapping. In the source code, there is one file per program in which we can see the use of mmap. All free softwares addressed in this talk will work like this. Let's see tools based on the frame buffer. First, we can run a terminal emulator named FVPad. We type, for example, the fbset command to print the frame buffer settings. FBPad allows to switch between tabs I switch to another tab, List PDF files, for example. And I come back to the first tab. This gives you a little overview of FBPAD. Let's have a look on how it works. The frame buffer is mapped. Pseudo terminal, master and slave are opened. A new process is created in which the shell is executed. Then, all keyboard inputs are sent to the slave and interpreted by the shell. The master reads the shell output characters, which are then drawn in the frame buffer. Image viewers are available. We're going to run FBI on FIM. These image viewers start with the frame buffer mapping. Image is read and decoded using common libraries like libjpeg or libpng. And then the frame buffer is just filled with the decoded data. Simple web browsers can be started. We're going to start NetSurf on its welcome page on links with a page that allows to make some color calibration on the monitor. Note that the mouse cursor drawing is managed by each program running on the frame buffer. In NetSurf, we type, for example, some text in the search area. Let's have a look in the implementation. For NetSurf, the frame buffer support is implemented in nib nsfb library. When this library is loaded, callback functions are registered. During NetSurf initialization, the Linux initialize callback function does the frame buffer mapping. Then, drawing functions write in the frame buffer for rendering the web page. For links, the mechanism is similar. The mmap is done at initialization and drawing functions write in the map area. Now I can show media players. We're going to run FBFF, which is based on the well-known FFmpeg libraries for audio-video decoding. And we're going to run the popular mPlayer. mPlayer logs show the use of FBDev, the frame buffer device interface. By pressing the space bar, we pause both players because when running programs on the frame buffer, there is no window manager. So window focus doesn't make sense. All input events are processed by all applications. For FBFF, we first have the mmap call. Then the frame buffer is directly filled with the decoded data to display. For mPlayer, a structure with callback functions is returned. One is the config function for the frame buffer mapping, and another one is the drawSlides function for filling the frame buffer with the decoded data. The last tool I'm going to show is FBPDF, the tool I'm using today for this presentation. FBPDF comes with two programs, one relying on Poplar library and the other one relying on MuPDF library. These two libraries are commonly used for managing PDF. For the same reason that we don't have a window manager when running programs on the frame buffer, by pressing the down key, we go to next page on both documents. As usual, we start with the mmap call. Poplar or MuPDF are used for getting the PDF page to render, and the frame buffer is filled with it. Drawing libraries can be used with the frame buffer. The first one we're going to see is Kero. We can experiment it with Kero demo softwares, and note that two different projects with the same name exist. The first project provides a simple program named Kero FB that just draws a line. The second project provides animations that show the possibilities of Kero. Some information for developing with Kero. We first create a target surface for the frame buffer, in our case. It's possible to pass the pointer on the frame buffer, so all drawings are directly visible. But depending on what you want to do, double buffering may be required. In this case, all drawings operations are done in a surface located in RAM. Then a context is created and the Kero API is called for drawing. For the rendering, you can use some Kero functions or just get the pointer of the drawing area and fill the frame buffer with its content. The second library we are going to see is EVAS, which is part of the EFL project. A frame buffer port is available. We can illustrate it with the expedite program. When running expedite, we specify FB in the option to use the frame buffer engine. We can play quickly with expedite. And for developing with EVAS, we first set up what we call a canvas. In our case, it's a canvas for the frame buffer that we indicate with the FB string. the next function leads to the frame buffer mapping. Drawing is done with the EVAS API, and for viewing it, called the EVAS render function. The next section is devoted to OpenGL rendering in the frame buffer. Thanks to the Mesa 3D project, it's possible to make OpenGL in pure software and render it in the frame buffer. To do this, an old interface named GLFBDev can be used. It consists of OpenGL extension for the frame buffer, and it's very similar to the well-known GLX extension available for the X window system. The newer EGL interface, which is more generic, is also supported. Let's have a look on this GLFBDev extension. We can find an example of use in Mesa Demo or in Jaegger's softwares. We are going to run GLFBDev test coming from Mesa Demo. And we are going to run Jaegger's. A word about the Jaegger's project, as we'll see it again in the presentation. Jaegger's is another implementation of the popular OpenGL demo named Gears, but which supports many OpenGL rendering methods. That's why, when running Jaegger's, we specify GLFBDev in the options to use GLFBDev extension. The first GLFBDev function called is GLFBDev create buffer, in which we pass the pointer on the frame buffer. The setWindow function is used for setting the size and the position of the frame buffer area in which OpenGL is rendered. Then, a context needs to be created and attached to the frame buffer. The swapBuffer function is called for filling the frame buffer with the 3D drawing. With EGL interface, it's similar. An example of use is available in Mesa Demo or in Jaegger's softwares. We are going to run EGL try FBDev coming from Mesa Demo. And we are going to run Jaegger's, but this time we specify EGL FBDev in the options to use EGL interface. Unlike GLFBDev implementation that was based on the legacy infrastructure of Mesa, EGL implementation for the frame buffer is based on Gallium infrastructure. The first EGL function call is the EGL getDisplay function. As EGL is a generic interface, if the Mesa library on your system supports other platforms like X, Wayland, or DRM, choose the platform support to use by setting EGL platform. It is set to FBDev in our case. Then the initialize function is called. And if we follow the frame buffer implementation in Gallium with the state trackers on WinSys components, we arrive on the frame buffer mapping. The create Windows Surface function is used for setting the frame buffer area in which OpenGL is rendered. It's important to note that the structure in argument depends on the platform. With the X platform, a X window is used in this function. Like glfbdev, a context needs to be created and attached to the frame buffer. Finally, the swap buffer function is called for filling the frame buffer with the 3D drawing. Note that I just detailed where to look in source code if you want to find out more. Multimedia frameworks. Popular multimedia frameworks have a frame buffer output. Note that all the video display is done in CPU when using the frame buffer. The first multimedia framework we're going to see is FFmpeg. For each multimedia framework demo, we will start a video and display an image. The FFmpeg command is launched with many options, but the most important here is the FBDev format specified for the output. In the implementation, the libAV device library provides the frame buffer support with a structure that contains two callback functions used during the transcode. The FBDev write header function for the frame buffer mapping and the FBDev write packet function for filling the frame buffer with the raw video. The second multimedia framework that can be used with the frame buffer is GStreamer. We run the GST launch tool for building a pipeline in which we specify the FBDev sync element for the output. The old 0.10 version and the newer 1.x version of GStreamer are started in the demo. How it works. The FBDev sync element is provided by a plugin in which we have again one function for the frame buffer mapping and one function for filling the frame buffer with the decoded data. Another multimedia framework working with the frame buffer is Xin, a program named FBigXin. Is available for testing this frame buffer support. In the implementation, the Xin open video driver function is called with the FBString in order to use the frame buffer plugin. Then it's always the same mechanism, call mmap and fill the frame buffer. The last multimedia framework we're going to see is VLC. When running the VLC command, we specify FB in the options to use the frame buffer video output module. Here, it's the same ID. A plugin with the FrameBuffer support is loaded. This plugin implements the create function for the mmap and the display function for filling the FrameBuffer. Once again, details about the source code are only for information if you want to find out more. Now, I'm going to present graphics libraries that provide an abstraction of the graphics backend, an abstraction of the frame buffer in our case. The first one is the GLUT library, in which a frame buffer port is available. GLUT allows to develop OpenGL programs with portable code. Since OpenGL comprises Unreal rendering, GLUT is useful for managing inputs in the program. We can experiment the frame buffer port of GLUT. We are going to run ProjTek on Reflect coming from Mesa Demo. On the Jaegers project that we have seen before, is launched with GLUT in the options to use GLUT API. We can see that the mouse cursor is well managed by GLUT. And here is the Jaegers. The frame buffer port in GLUT directly relies on the GLFBDev extension that we have already seen for OpenGL rendering. Let's have a look on SDL, a popular library that provides a graphical and system layer for programming cross-platform applications. We can illustrate the frame buffer port of SDL. We are going to run two tests coming from SDL on the Jaegers project is launched with SDL in the options to use SDL API. This time, the mouse cursor is managed by SDL. And here is the Jaegers. If we look the frame buffer port in SDL, we can see the frame buffer mapping done at initialization. And when we call functions like SDL flip for updating the screen, the frame buffer is written. For OpenGL rendering, the EGL interface that we have already seen is used by SDL. Now, let's talk about user interface toolkits. The first one we're going to see is Elementary, which is part of the EFL project. We have already mentioned this project in the presentation. When we have talked about the EVAS drawing library on its frame buffer engine, in EFL architecture, EVAS library, but also eCore library, allow Elementary to work on the frame buffer. We are going to run Elementary test, in which we can test many Elementary widgets. And we are going to run Jaegers with EFL in the options to use an Elementary GLView widget. We can play quickly with elementary tests. On air is Jaegers. In the implementation, we can see the use of EVAS for drawing in the frame buffer. OpenGL rendering is based on the generic EVAS GL interface available in EVAS library. And for the frame buffer, this EVAS GL interface directly relies on GL FBDev extension. Another toolkit for creating graphical user interface is GTK. It relies on the color drawing library that we have seen before in this presentation. OpenGL rendering into a GTK widget is possible using GTKGL Area interface. We can experiment the frame buffer port of GTK. To do this, we are going to run GTK demo in which we can test many GTK widgets. And we are going to run Jaegers with GTK in the options to use a GTKGL Area widget. We can play quickly with GTK demo. And here is Jaegers. How it works? We have the frame buffer mapping done at initialization. And we can see the use of Keru for drawing widgets. For OpenGL rendering, GTK GL Era directly relies on GL FBDev extension. At the beginning of the presentation, we have started with a blue rectangle. Then, we have seen the Keru drawing library, the OpenGL rendering, and on this basis, GTK. We have also tested the GStreamer multimedia framework. So we have everything for running a high-level application on the frame buffer. I propose to show, as example, the WebKit browser for GTK. We are going to start the GTK launcher application available in WebKit GTK for running a WebGL demo on the HTML5 media player. The last user interface toolkit we are going to see is Qt. A frame buffer port is available. Just note that, depending on the version, the implementation is based on QWS or on QPA infrastructure. We can illustrate the frame buffer port of Qt by running Qt demo, in which we can test many Qt widgets. And we're going to run Jaegers with Qt in the options to use a QGL widget. We can play quickly with Qt demo. And here is Jaegers. I'm going fast on the next two slides that just detail where to look in the code for understanding the frame buffer port in Qt. But you know that we have the mmap call. And for OpenGL rendering, EGL is used by Qt. As we did for GTK, I propose to show the WebKit browser for Qt. We are going to start the Qt test browser application available in Qt WebKit for running the same WebGL demo on the same HTML5 media player that we have seen before with GTK. Now you can imagine all kinds of applications running directly on the frame buffer. Before finishing, just some extra information. If you need a compositor for managing multiple applications, or if you have an application that really depends on X, for example, or for anything else, it's still possible to use the frame buffer with graphics backend like DirectFB, X, or Wayland. But in this case, all we have seen in the presentation is completely different. For instance, with X, the GTK port for X will be used. Keyword drawing will be done in the X window. GLX extension will be used for OpenGL rendering, and everything will rely on the X window system. That's why I'm saying it's another story. And I will finish with a few words on the origins of this presentation. Everything started with a Linux from scratch distribution 15 years ago for understanding how graphics work and for playing with many different graphics backend. And I realized that some graphics backend won't be maintained anymore and now belong to the past. That's why I created the IGFX back project in order to preserve them. Thanks.
Any questions?
Yes.
Nico, thank you very much for assembling all this information in one place. Great talk. I have a question is, when you are writing directly to FBDev, how can you synchronize with VSync to avoid the tune?
In practice, the question is, with FBDev, how I synchronize with VSync, if it's correct. In practice, I don't have to care about it. Everything, I think, it's managed at low level in the kernel drivers on the really low level hardware. Now I just call mmap, I have the pointer on the frame buffer, and just fill Yeah.
Have you tried to run Firefox or Chrome in the framework?
The question is if I ever tried to run Firefox or Chromium. Personally, no, but I encourage you to try it. Could be a little complex, but yes, Chromium was based at the origins on the WebKit browsers, so you are not too far away from that. For Firefox, it's completely different, but I think you have some work before having Firefox running on it. But I come back to this slide. You still can use X, and it will work on X on the frame buffer with all its complexity. Yes.
I joined my colleague over there. Thank you for the great presentation and like the really good overview of the thing. It looks really fun to play with and quite simple to work with. So like the programmer in me is quite happy about that. Now I'm thinking about this and I'm trying to think of use cases and I can see a few of them. But I'm wondering, I don't want to miss anything, so I'm wondering what in your opinion are like, great use cases of frame buffer. Like when it's really, really justified to use it.
So, if I have well understand the question is the use case of the frame buffer.
What, in your opinion, is like the best examples you know of the use cases of the frame buffer?
For sure, the frame buffer is deprecated. Now it's KMS, DLLM, and for the future, it won't be the frame buffer for sure, but the frame buffer on some embedded systems. Sometimes, if you don't have GPU or hardware, you can still use the frame buffer for drawing on small TFT screen, for example. And that's right. Don't expect to have your 3D games engine working like this, or to play your 4K streams in the frame buffer. But the frame buffer is just, I think, useful for understanding how things work. As example, in Mesa, the Gallium infrastructure, for some people who have a little look in it, I think it's complex. And as the frame buffer is really simple, you can really focus on the Gallium infrastructure for understanding how it works. And also because the frame buffer is in pure software, you can differentiate if an issue is coming from the hardware or coming from the software implementation. It can be, but for sure, I started by saying in free softwares, the frame buffer support is sometimes removed. And so you have to look in the log on in the history to find the frame buffer support in some software. And don't know, SDL2, for example, GTK3. For example, don't have the frame buffer support. So, yes, it's a little bit a problem. But,
can I actually?
Yes.
I would like to know, suppose you are writing an application working directly on the frame buffer. How can you get notification from the kernel about the resolution of the frame buffer, in particular if the resolution changes or if the monitor gets detached and so on? Because recently I've written an application for an embedded device that uses the frame buffer to do a sort of PLC to display remotely on the embedded device a Beagle board black. And the only way I've seen to get information about the frame buffer is using an IOCTL and periodically polling to get information about the resolution.
Yes, if I were well understanding the question concerns the resolution. If it changes during the program running, typically. Yes, it's a good question. And in my case, the resolution, I always use a static resolution. So I don't have this issue. And the polling mechanism you have implemented, I think it's a solution to address this kind of use case.
Question kind of clearly. You first have to differentiate what you're calling frame buffer, which is FBCON, versus the new DRM KMS stuff, which has the same features. You can literally create a buffer, mem map it, and fill it with pixels exactly like you do with FBCON. Now, the difference is that with new DRM KMS, you get to vsync that and get rid of all the tearing, etc., and get that all correct, but it otherwise can work exactly the same way. Now, taking that into account, what's the use of this stuff? Particularly I know EFL because I wrote that code, and it supports FBCON because I wrote that code, and I know it's single buffered and it copies everything to the screen exactly as you described. I've also got the DRM KMS code, and the same application works as zero lines change, it just works. So a great use of it is run terminology, which is a terminal emulator, in your TTY, and if it's FBCON, it'll use FBCON. If it's DRM KMS, that's what you have, it'll use that instead. And then you get everything vsync, and now you get a fast console where scrolling is fast. Have you ever done a make in TTY and gone and made a cup of coffee and come back? That doesn't happen now, it's fast, because the kernel TTY doesn't play catch-up. It just does every line really brute force in a really dumb scroll. Proper terminals will just play catch-up and will scroll instantly. You can also then, in a terminal emulator, play videos, look at images, etc. Type tycat, file it in MP4 and it plays a video. In the terminal emulator. It'll also do splits and tabs and all the usual stuff. That, if you want to do that, you can run effectively kind of an i3/sway like GUI in just one big terminal in your TTY and not need a display system at all. So that is a use case for that. If you assume that DRM KMS in the memmap model is effectively the same thing as FBCON, which is what you're kind of strictly talking about.
So if I understand correctly, what you're saying is if I open a terminal to a remote machine, suddenly I'm not limited to text anymore. I can open like a graphic session to a remote machine.
No. That one's local. It uses escapes to basically tell the terminal, here's a file path or a URI to this thing. The terminal goes, I'll load that for me. And it just keeps just the URI in the actual terminal history thing, so it doesn't give all the pixels. So it's kind of compact. And can rebuild it so you can scroll through history and find all these things and it'll reload them back in without keeping them in memory. So that's why it won't work remotely. Unless it's a URI which both systems can access, like a actual URL, HTTP, blah, blah, blah. But yeah, that's a use case. But again, it depends on your definition of frame buffer. If you're being really strict, say FBCON or DRM KMS.
Where is that link between the TTY device and the frame buffer? How can I determine which frame buffer device corresponds to my current TTY where my program is running? Mm-hmm. Does it even make sense?
Yes. Here. So here the system directly run on the frame buffer, but you have a TTY. It's supported by the kernel which provides the console, the TTY, on the frame buffer. And I come back to when I fill the frame buffer with random values, let's say I'm filling my TTY with random values, but in memory I have another TTY, and I can still access I have only one frame buffer. And here I fill the second TTY with random values. And if I'm coming back to the first TTY, I have the content of my command in it, which is restored. And I can switch back, but
the driver renders to the same frame buffer. When you switch it,
yes,
everything gets rerun.
But there is only one frame buffer.
Thanks.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you.